slightly different ones up there, but we shall see.
Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity to talk about my stuff. As I just said a minute ago, those of you sitting at the back, you might want to move a bit further forward because there is some kind of text and stuff. So if you're not really that bothered, that's fine. But you will probably be squinting at the screen in a wee bit. I'm going to talk to you about some work that we did over the last kind of year or so, I guess. It's taken a long time and I'll explain why that was. To convert some old digital format, file format objects from a format called WordStar, and how we converted them into HTML and why we did it and kind of what mattered about that process. And so this is basically what I'm going to just talk through. Now, I didn't really know from the audience kind of whether we want to get really down to the technical bits or whether we want to talk about the kind of curatorial stuff. So there's lots of various bits that I could talk to, and I'm just going to ask a quick show of hands. The three options you will be given, I'm going to ask you for are, do you just want a general overview about a little bit of everything? Do you want to know about the technical bits? Or do you want to know about the kind of more curatorial side of things? So question one was the general, show of hands. Question two was technical. Question three, I knew your hand would be up there. Question three was the curatorial. All right, so it's pretty evenly split, and we're going to go with general, so you're going to get a little bit of everything. That kind of makes a bit of sense, I guess. Again, those people who have just kind of wandered in, thank you very much. If you want to move a bit further forward so you can read, you probably might find it a bit more engaging. So I'm going to tell you why we chose WordStar. I'm going to talk to you what we thought we would do. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the set, but that's kind of less relevant, I guess. And then what we ended up doing and how we worked with the curator and a bunch of tools that we made. And then, of course, finally, some lessons. The primary question is, why do we choose WordStar? And what are we actually trying to achieve? What we're trying to achieve here was deal with content, which we would describe as being functionally obsolete. WordStar is a very old format. It's kind of it was around in the 1980s. WordStar for DOS was quite prevalent. It was a really new and exciting way of writing stuff in those days. There was a WordStar for Windows when Windows 3.11 kind of turned up, but it rapidly stopped being very relevant. There was a bunch of legal stuff happened, and of course technology overran and it disappeared. So I can access them because I'm a nerd and I spend my life looking at this stuff. But if I gave you one of these files, you'd kind of go, I don't really get it. What do I do with this? It doesn't really mean anything. My computer says no. So we know that this stuff is what we would argue as being at risk, and we want to do something with it. But secondarily, what we wanted to do was start to test that assertion around what is a preservation action. We talk in the preservation community about doing preservation actions in this very meaningful and very kind of upright way. We'll do a preservation action and we'll save the content and then life goes on. But what we haven't done as a community really is delve into what that actually means and what that feels like and how do we make sure that we're doing the right things to our content. And this was kind of a chance for us in the library to explore what that means and how that feels and how do we make sure that we're doing the right thing technically, we're doing the right thing intellectually, and we're doing the right thing curatorially to content. So we were doing two things. One was actually WordStar because it was there and it has a need, and the second is because we needed to start somewhere and it was a relatively low barrier of entry, really. So the initial plan of attack, we basically said, hey, what do? We'll find all the WordStar files. We'll find a converter on the internet because there's definitely one that will exist. We'll test it and we'll make sure it works because, you know, we're doing due diligence. We'll convert everything. We will show the curator how we've done this and how it's cool and how nothing's changed. And, you know, the objects that we're putting into the system are still the same. And then we'll just shove it all back in the permanent repository and life goes on and we can go and look at something else cool. And that seems pretty straightforward and the way we would expect to do business. Of course, doesn't really work like that. So we ended up having to do quite a lot of work, and it became technically quite an involved process. We were fortunate that some of my colleagues and previous colleagues had some insight, and they kind of collected some older kit. And this is a laptop that I got to use, which is pretty fun. Toshiba Satellite T2130. You can see those wicked specs right there, 32 meg of RAM. That is smashing it. That thing doesn't work anymore. The power supply died halfway through this project. So, I mean, I could kind of take it apart and try and fix it, but, you know, it kind of served its purpose. And it kind of talks about the fragility of the mechanisms. We found WordStar 4 on eBay, and we got it shipped over for, I think it cost us like $3.44 plus shipping from the States. So it ended up about $50 probably. And we got that shipped over. And then, of course, we found an old printer, which just so happened to be able to plug in and work with that laptop. There was nothing magical about that. We just plugged it in and it happened because some clever people did some clever stuff early on. So that was kind of like a way we could go back and test things, right? Because we've got the original, basically the original mechanisms that this stuff was created on. This is a scan photograph of some WordStar WordStar content, and this was just a spoof document I made to show like kind of the things that we're dealing with. And there is a pointer on here, so here we go. So you know, it's the application itself supports bold, italic, underline, tabbed characters, which are the same as a space character. Visually, you can't tell the difference. It understands font to a degree, so it allowed me to understand this was the original font. It allowed me to change the font and allowed me to change the font back again. So there's a bunch of instructions that we find inside the format, which mean that we can tell you some things about markup and content. Cool. Okay, so we know there's a bunch of stuff which is relevant to us. As custodians of this content, as technical custodians of this content, we need to be, kind of be aware of that, right? Because when I move this stuff into another format, do I need to maintain the boldness? Do I need to maintain the italicization? I think that's a word. Do we need to maintain the underlining? And one would argue, probably yes, but we need a mechanism of establishing why. Is it actually relevant? Do we need to deal with the complexity? Douglas, a question. That's what that calls italics. So that's what it said. There's weeds, and I can talk to you about them in, a separate time, and you'll see in a minute why that perhaps is relevant. But that is what it said was italic. That's just what happens. We also have a bunch of stuff which is not visible on this slide, and we'll talk to it in a minute. It's about things like line wrapping. So as a format, it said, I occupy 80-ish characters on a line, and then I'm going to start a new line for you. Technical custodians, we spent a long time arguing and discussing and thinking about the relevance of that line. Is that line a meaningful semantic unit in this textual object? Was it important to the creator of that document, a document, that the line was a specific length and the line wrapping, therefore, is something which needs to be preserved? And that is a question that we talked to for quite a long time. Page numbering is another thing which appears in the format. It actually appears as a default function inside the program. It's nothing to do with the file object that was in my hand. So what do we do with that? What do we do with those pieces of information? This is what actually you see on the screen. And so this was a whole other series of questions that we needed to look at. So this talks to your point a little bit, Douglas. So on screen, this is what you see. This is normal text, and that's what it looked like when it was printed out. This is bold text, and we can see it's bold because it's got these kind of markup characters, and this is what it looked over here. This is italic text. Now, it doesn't work because perhaps there's a break between the PostScript information that's pushed over to the printer, and it doesn't actually fully understand what this instance of italic is. So what does that mean to us? You know, is that important? We do know originally, on the original object that we see, an italic instance has been argued for over here. Whether that's a renderance of an italic object is slightly not really relevant because we printed that and it's not really an actual artifact that we care that much about. And then equally on the underline, we have a similar kind of markup. So one of the primary questions was, what is important here? Is it this bit, which is what the creator made and they sat in front of the computer and typed that out? Or is it the resulting textual object that came out the other side? Is that the bit that we're actually interested in preserving? Do we need to preserve this bit, or is that a vehicle to get to this printed instance? And so we spent a long time talking about that. And one of the decisions we made in this project was that in this instance, we care about this object, we don't care about that object. So we care about the application of those instructions, we don't care that those instructions need to be manifested in a visual way. Does that make sense? So we kind of threw away these tags. We used them behind the scenes, but we said actually we don't need to show the reader these tags because they're not actually that relevant. We're lucky that we have an incredibly powerful preservation system in the National Library, and so we used the preservation system to pick up our stuff. Throughout this, you'll know there's a few times I've done some modification simply to protect the anonymity of the content that we have. This is all oral history content. We've got 37 of these files. It's not really a lot of content, right? This is a very small number of files, which actually means it's a nice manageable number. It means that we can do something meaningful with that. We're not kind of swamped with volume, which is what rapidly happens going forward. And they all came from the same oral history project. So it turns out that all these WordStar files were written by a library colleague doing a report for the library, which is to transcribe some oral library oral histories that we have. So we've got the audio, and we have the transcripts, and these are those transcripts basically. So that's kind of nice. It's an internal thing. We own some of the QA, if you like, about those objects. So we used Rosetta to pull those stuff out. It's super simple, and they all came in the same project, 1986. That's relatively straightforward. So we got to this piece about checking the converters. We went, it's fine, because some smart person will have done this for us. We'll throw it at the converters, and then we'll just test it and go, yep, Apple still says apples. Underline is still underline. And we found 8 different codecs that worked, and they mainly sucked. And they really, really, really sucked. And of the 8 of them, only 2 of them gave me back meaningful digital objects that I could engage with. The other 6 either failed completely, or they gave me back broken PDFs or broken RTF files that didn't open properly, didn't render properly, and they just failed, which had us scratching our heads. Is it because our content was malformed? Is this just a function of dealing with stuff which is getting old? I mean, you know, 86, 30 years ago, this stuff is pretty old, right? Is it because our stuff was malformed? Is it worth the effort trying to go back to these guys that are making the software and say, hey, your software is a bit rubbish. Actually, it might be our content because we've only got 39 files to test. We don't really know. We had to ask lots of questions around where do we put our effort? Where do we put our resource? We decided that no single tool could handle the full set. And as a result, we're dealing with text. We're dealing with, by the time we'd got to this piece of work, we were quite comfortable that we understood the format. We could probably just do something ourselves in this instance, and it would solve our problem, and we don't need to deal with that. Is that probably the best way? No. Is that a sustainable way? Probably not. But it meant that we could kind of keep going with this project. I mean, we could keep testing up the curatorial and the kind of internal process parts of our inquiry. So this is what it looked like, and this is the bits those at the back. You will be struggling, and I apologize. This is kind of like what one of those objects look like if you open it in a normal viewer. And so you need to kind of convince it to open it in the first place because it's not going to natively open. And this is on a Linux text renderer. And you start to see all this kind of like funny gubbins up here, like weird characters. And this is actually the markup that we saw before, the underlining and the bolding. We see line endings, which is like we talked about line endings and whether they're meaningful. So, you know, intellectually, it's all pretty much there. And again, I've made some redactions, so none of the initials and locations are actually the same, what they were. It's just person A, person B, person C, blah, blah. So you can see that, like, it's kind of mainly there, but it's not quite there. And this kind of, when we got to this piece, this bit's really easy to get to. It's pretty trivial to get a relatively readable, derivative of the content in a meaningful way. But that's not what we saw on the bit of paper. The bit of paper that we started off with that was intended to be printed didn't have these characters. It didn't have these weird blocks over here. So we know that we need to do something to it to kind of coerce it into some shape. So that's really basically what we were looking at. The other thing of note as well, and we talked about, is it relevant to have the bolding and the underlining? We start to notice patterns. So over here we can see we've got a person. Every time there's a person, we've got this kind of funny marker, which tells us that semantically they were using an underline function to denote a person. So there's a semantic inference around the aesthetic componentry that makes up this file. We know that that's kind of useful, that's meaningful to us. Could we say the same about this? We can certainly say that there's something about page endings, but is it semantically useful? Is that page semantically useful? Is the line semantically useful on the page? Is the page numbering semantically useful? There is no, I can't scroll down because it's not the full document, but there is no page numbering inherent in this document, but when I print it in WordStar, it prints me page numbers at the bottom. Is that a semantically inherent part of the object that we're preserving? Is it applied by the application? Does it belong in the format? Those are the kind of questions that we were arguing with. And we answered those questions and we said, the underlining is super important. The boldification is super important. The lines are not that important, because we know that we can do something meaningful in other formats and we can use the application to define them. There's no semantic inference on the line. What is semantically valuable is probably the paragraph. So as long as we maintain that structure and that we do hard line breaks properly, so this would be a hard line break as opposed to this being a soft line break, that's okay. We're maintaining the semantic kind of flow of this piece of discourse. So we allow ourselves that, and we also said the page numbering's, again, not important, because we're reflowing this intellectual content into another page shape container. The page numbers become irrelevant because we're not controlling how many lines that we show, because we've already decided that the line width itself is not a semantic function of this document. Does that make sense? So we kind of start to get in this really fuzzy, weird area that says, how do we, what's important and what's valuable? We allowed ourselves with this content to make that decision, but we argue very strongly, and there's a paper that I'll point you to at the end, that says every single collection needs to be assessed on its content. You can't make these technical assessments without understanding the content itself. So in this content, we think we're allowed to do that. Other content, if it was poetry, if there was some kind of artistic license used in the layout, then the layout needs to be preserved in a slightly different way. So we did a different solution. We basically, it sounds clever, reverse engineered the format. We basically just kind of just looked at it and reframed the tags. We put it into a new format, and we worked really hard on the look and feel, and we'll get to that, and I'll show give an example at the minute. And the other thing was to give the curator an example of how to assess that transformation and make sure that it kind of makes sense and it was meaningful and that they understood what they were signing off to. The technical people, the nerdy people in the room will go, yep, we've done all this clever stuff. What we want to do is make sure they're not going, that sounds awesome, well done. They're going, I understand exactly what you did, where I need to, and that I feel comfortable saying, yes, this is an appropriate piece of work and you've handled it in the right way, you know, using it as, you've handled this digital Tonga in the way that I expect you to. We get all the sign-offs and then it goes into the repository and lives forever. We picked HTML because it was super easy. So we're basically describing a marked up format. We could have picked any bunch of formats, and we had some really long and interesting conversations around what is the best format. It's a textual object. We could have used doc, we could have used docx, we could have used RTF, we could have used a number of other kind of containers. We chose HTML because it allows us some really easy mechanisms of getting to that markup. It supports bold, underline, it has font management, allows us to do this paragraph indentation, and we can control these things in a really simple way. And we've got heaps of HTML, so if we have a preservation issue with HTML, this is the least of our worries. You know, the rest of the collection that's HTML was probably something we should be worried of. This is a kind of a view into the nerdy land of what we were actually playing with. I'm not going to spend too long on it, but these are what those markers look like. So this is the bold marker, it's actually a bytecode 13, a hex bytecode 13. It was actually pretty straightforward, apart from when there were errors. What we also found was the application did a little bit of self-cleaning. So if the author didn't close the bold tags, it wouldn't persist with boldness throughout the rest of the document. It would go, oh, you've started a new paragraph, you probably don't want bold anymore, I'll switch bold off for you. But it doesn't appear in the document, it appears in the logic of the application. So we spent a long time trying to unpick when we found errors, when we did some of the early transformations, when it would start with bold and the whole document was in bold, we had to figure out why there was no closing bold tag. Does that make sense? So we're trying to kind of, again, reverse engineer the logic of an application which is entirely blind to us. We don't really know what it's doing, and we have to try and use some sensible logic to decode that. This was really the most important and valuable part of the project for me, I think. And we sat down and we created this, we called it a text object criteria review sheet. And I worked with a whole bunch of our colleagues and Peter McKinney put this together. And we used a whole bunch of different assessment criteria from heaps of different sources, which basically said of all of the aesthetic componentry that you might find in a text object, what is important to you as a curator of this content? What do you understand? What do you want us to pay special attention to? And more importantly, what do we not need to worry about so much? And again, you might not be able to read it from here, but it talks about boldness, and it talks about diacritics, and it talks about figures, and you know, what have you. And so we kind of said, is it important, not important? And we went through and made comments and discussed with the curator in real great verbose detail whether we decide, and this is how we got to that bit around whether lines are important or not. So the curators were comfortable that we're not just doing things willy-nilly to the content, that they're comfortable that we're touching content in a meaningful way. And any changes or transformations that we make, because we have to, because technology changes, are done in such a way that are defendable and that can be kind of accounted for over time. So this form sheet took, I'm not kidding, took hours. Part of it was testing the process, and part of it was making sure that everybody in the room understood the minute implications of the little decisions that we were making along the way. That's some nerdery, we won't go into too much, but basically we just use Python because Python's amazing and it's tech stuff, and it was a win-win. I'm not gonna go through that in any detail. And this is kind of what we end up with. So Over here is the HTML. This is never shown to the reader unless they kind of view source. But this is the equivalent of that kind of markup stuff that you saw on screen, right? You know, the author didn't write it to look like that. Somebody writing HTML writes it to look like this. And over here, you can see that we've got the underlining. We've got, and you'll see they've made a mistake. They didn't underline that piece. It doesn't exist. There is no markup in that section that, that requires it. So, you know, we have to persist with errors as they are. One of my favorite conversations that we had on this topic was that of font. When we first did this, I just used the default browser font, right? I didn't touch font in any way, shape, or form. Because in the text object, the file format doesn't talk about font in any way, shape, or form. It just says, I am a text character. The curator said, New Times Roman, though, it's not contemporary. It wasn't used, you know, we didn't. So I was like, okay, well, what font do we want it to be? I don't know, what font was it? Well, I don't know, because I've never seen it printed. All I know is the text object that we have. And we had this really fabulous discussion, which resulted in us using Courier, because it feels contemporary. And one of the justifications of what we said was, the default in the program, and we looked at a number of different instances of the WordStar program, always defaults as Courier of that day. It's a contemporary decision. The default settings in an application, unless we know better, were probably used by the author. If they really cared about font, and we did some testing around font and I showed you that earlier, we would have seen some clear indicators in the thing that said, hey, we've used a different font. So that's what we result with. This is HTML, and this is that stuff moved 30 years into the future, which is what we have. We also built another tool, which I'm not going to talk about too much because I don't really have the time, but we wanted to give the curator a method of testing the veracity of what we've done. This tool we built, which basically strips away all of that markup and puts in the original and the converted, just the words without any of the markup, and it was designed to break the moment you have so this is red and that says read, the moment there's an intellectual discrepancy with the text content, it would break and tell you there's a problem here. And we gave that to the curator with all of the converted materials and said, this is your opportunity to go through. Behind the scenes, we do all of this logging anyway because we're nerds and we do that kind of stuff. So we know that everything that comes out is perfect. And if it's not perfect, we know why it's not perfect. But that's not my decision as the content owner, as the content kind of curator, to make that decision. And I needed a vehicle to allow the curator to make those kind of meaningful decisions and not just trust me that I've done a good job, so that they can go through and wade through this content in a structured way. So it turns out this tool was super useful. So in wrapping up, the lessons that we kind of picked up were you need to know your content, and I really do mean know your content. Technically, aesthetically, and informationally, you need to know what it's doing. You need to have some notion of intent. What's the preservation intent of this object? What is it doing for me? What's the technical gubbins under the hood? We know what every single byte in these objects does, which is awesome. But it's kind of like nerdy, and not many people really need to get down to that level. So we need to make tools which allow us to bridge those two divides and allow people who care about the aesthetic and about the information to be hidden from the horrible technical bits, and allow the technical people to do their job and the curatorial people to deal with the aesthetic and the informational part. And we all kind of come together and agree what we need to do. Trusting into processes that was another really, really interesting one. We kind of naively thought we could just pick up these converters and then deploy them and then they would work. And it turns out they don't work and we don't really know what they're doing. So how do we trust what they're doing? They're black boxes. You have an input, you have an expected output. But if you don't know what's happening inside, how can you be sure that it's not really messing with this stuff on the innards? And we had another long conversation where some of the first HTML we produced, when I said, this conversion tool can make HTML, how about I just squirt in another bit of HTML which changed the font? That was heresy at that time. You know, the tool did it. Why would you want to touch something a tool made? And I kind of said, but we know what we're doing as technical people. We're not adding any voodoo. We're adding another bit of knowledge. But the tool was trusted more than it probably ought to have done. So this trust in processes, it's probably better to really know what's going on under the hood so you know exactly what's happening. And then the final things, which is kind of standard in tech space, if you make things, make them reusable because they pay off quickly. All of the IP that we made for this project, we've now got two further projects which we're just waiting for the kind of a start date to just see how quickly we can do it. This was an exercise in really seeing what we needed to do. Now we know what the process is. We've got WordStar 2000, we've got a bunch of them, and we've got some electronic typewriter material. Which also similarly, you know, actually all of these processes and tools are identical. All that's different is that kind of nerdy conversion of the weird markup. It's irrelevant to the curator. What's relevant is that they get the aesthetic object and the informational object that they thought they had. So that was my talk. Thank you very much for your time. Any questions?
Questions?
Hello.
First getting all that stuff that you had to do and getting the finished product.
Yeah.
I just wanted an idea of how in my library I can allocate resources.
That is a great question, and I'm not going to give you an answer that you're going to like nor think is useful. It really depends what you're measuring. In terms of actual work time, we probably could do it. I would argue, you know, it would take a person a week roughly to do the technical analysis we understand. This is a relatively trivial text format. Again, let's be very clear, it's in a very simple space. To make sure we understand it fully, to do a converter, reusing the IP we've already made. I reckon it'll take us about a week for each of the other two new formats that we have. This actually took us the best a year on and off because we really sat down and chewed on the problem. We wanted to take it slow. We wanted to bring the curator staff with the technical staff on a journey. So we purposefully did it in a laborious way. So you can do it a hell of a lot quicker. The answer is, don't know. We've never really done it as a let's do it properly, start to finish, get it done. But I reckon the technical bits you can do, I've estimated about a week for each of the two new formats that we have. Any other questions? Yes.
Can I just ask, say you had the printout of that.
Yes. My life would be so much easier. Yes.
Would you consider it still important to do the preservation of the file for the WordStar and the HTML?
That is an excellent question, and I would defer you at that point to policy people. I would defer you to your collections policy people, and I would say that that's a decision of the curator. If the curator says, I'm comfortable that the print matter is all that matters in this instance, and the digital part is not that relevant, then that's their decision. That what I'm saying is that's not on my desk, don't know. Any other questions? I would hope so. Yeah, I really, really hope so. And so, you know, I'm not really a programmer, and so everything I built is a bit rubbish. And I would feel very nervous about putting it in the public space. Anybody can ask me for it, and I'll give it to them. What I don't want to do is let it go without there lots of kind of caution words around using it. So the next time we do it, we'll refine things and we'll make it better and so on and so forth. And if other people want to use the same stuff and make it better, I mean, that's entirely the model that we need to have. It's not sustainable to do it in this way. That's, you know, primary lesson number one. So it belongs out in the open space, and we want to make tools which are simple. The reason we wrote the that tester was exactly for that reason. I could have shown the logs to the curators. They would have, you know, just got frustrated. They're not easy to use. So I really think that's definitely a good thing, and we should be doing. And the more people that ask us to do this stuff, the more it's likely to kind of happen, I guess. Awesome. I've probably taken more of the time than I ought. And I have one more question. Oh, yeah, sure. Hey.
Speaking as one of them policy people, Joe,
yes.
I'm just wondering about sharing IP.
Yes.
Can we talk about this offline?
Sure, absolutely. I'd love to.
Okay, thank you, Joe.
No worries, thank you.